Welcome to all of you. Hello friends, how are you? A very warm welcome to all of you. So friends, as you know that on our channel we are covering the syllabus of UPSC CSE 2019, and for that purpose we have started multiple series on our channel that target your prelims as well as mains. So friends, currently we have 7 series that target your prelims and 1 series that target your mains. So friends, basically what we do in prelim series, we daily cover 10 questions. We pick up one topic and we cover 10 MCQs of those of that topic. So friends, one day has been allocated to each topic. For example, today is the day of ancient India and we will cover the 10 MCQs of ancient India. And tomorrow is the day of medieval India and we will cover the MCQs of medieval India. And so on, we will be covering the 7 topics in 7 days of the week. So friends, basically daily as we cover 10 questions, so we will continue to do so till 31st May. So why the date chosen has been 31st May? Because on 2nd June is your prelims of UPSC 2019 and we will end this series only one day before your prelims. So you can imagine that if you daily cover 10 questions, so already we are on the lecture number 21 of the ancient India. So if you count the number of days, then approximately if we say January is already ending, then February, March, April, May, and there are 4 months, approximately there are 120 days. So if you multiply with 10, then it amounts to 1200 questions. So we will be covering 1200 questions. So you can imagine that these numbers are quite large numbers, considering that if you do this much of practice, then there is a very, very great possibility of you excelling in the exam hall, because we will cover the questions that are of utmost importance. So in this way, your vision will also take place. So let's start our discussion, friends. Today is the day of ancient India. So the MCQ series, so lecture 21 is there. And first question is, with reference to economic history of medieval India, the term Visti refers to. So friends, there was a term called Visti that was used in medieval India, in the history of medieval India. So there is a mistake here. It must be ancient India. So this is related to A, bonded laborers; B, land grants made to military officers; C, land grants to the temples; D, wasteland converted to the cultivated land. So let me tell you friends that the correct option is A, that is bonded laborer. So friends, this is by mistake that I have included the medieval India question. So it must be the question must be of ancient India. So there was a lot of confusion when I was making this. I was making it in a hurry, so there might be some mistakes there. So friends, the correct answer is A, that is bonded labor. So basically Visti refers to medieval India, type of bonded labor or slaves. So that were forced to do work for the king. So Visti was the kind of forced labor kind of thing that the persons have to do for the king. So the solution is A. So it was a kind of used in the sense of forced labor, which the villagers were obliged to do to the kings or the state. So this was about your Visti. And let's move on to the question second question is, the book that gives an account of how Chandragupta Maurya overthrew the power of Nandas with the help of Kautilya is. So here we have been asked that which of the following was the book in which there are details that are mentioned about the overthrow of the Nandas by the Chandragupta Maurya. So which of the following describes that? So A is Arthashastra, B Kalpasutra, C Mrichkatika, and D Mudra Rakshasa. Let me tell you friends that the correct answer is C, that is Mrichkatika, which is D, that is Mudra Rakshasa of Vishakhadatta, in which it is explained that how Chandragupta Maurya overthrew the powerful Nandas out of the power with the help of Kautilya, that is Chanakya, who wrote the Arthashastra. So the correct answer is D, that is Mudra Rakshasa. So Mudra Rakshasa was basically, it was written by Vishakhadatta. So there are multiple historical sources that describe about the Chandragupta Maurya. We get to know about the Chandragupta Maurya from multiple historical sources. So they belong to Jain tradition or both Buddhist tradition as well as other traditions. So also we come to know about Chandragupta Maurya from secular tradition. So the correct answer is D, solution is D. So it gives the detail of how Chandragupta Maurya overthrew the power of Nandas with the help of Kautilya. So there are other sources as well which describe the life of Chandragupta Maurya. For example, Jain sources are Bhadrabahu's Kalp Sutras and Hemchandra's and Hemchandra's Prashist Parvan. So this describes about the life of Chandragupta Maurya. So there are also Brahmanical sources like Puranas and Chanakya's Arthashastra also there, and Vishakha's Mudra Rakshasa and Somdeva's Katha Shrist Katha Shrist Sagra and Shemchandra's Brit Katha Manjari. So there are names that are typical to pronounce. So Buddhist sources are also there like Deepamsa, Mahavamsa, Mahavamsa Tika and Mahabodhi Vamsa. So this is about your second question. Let's move on to the third question. So friends, third question is Indian national calendar is based on the Saka calendar starting in 78 CE. What is the significance of this date? So friends, you might be knowing that in India, Indian national calendar is based on Saka era. So if you don't, Saka calendar, if you don't know, then please remember it. It is an important fact. So Indian national calendar is based on the Saka calendar that started in 78 CE. So what is the significance of this date? A. It marks the victory of King Vikramaditya over the Sakas. B. It marks the accession of Kanishka. C. It marks the adoption of Buddhism by Ashoka. D. It marks the beginning of Satvahana ruler. Friends, let me tell you that C cannot be the answer because Ashoka came to the power, adopt, okay. Ashoka was in the BCs, not in the CEs, Christian eras. It was before Christian era. So C cannot be answer and D cannot be answer. The answer becomes here, friends, because let me tell you that that the A cannot be also be the answer because when the King Vikramaditya won over the Sakas, he started his era, and that was in 58 BC. So it was also in BC. So the 78 CE, that is Saka era, it was basically the date on which Kushana ruler Kanishk adopted the power. So it marks the accession of Kanishk. So the solution is B. So here is explanation. It is basically Saka, zero of Saka era, which began the Kanishka succeeded to throne of Kushan Empire, and the Vikram era is of 58 BC. That defines the option A. It marks the victory of King Vikramaditya over Sakas. So this is about your fourth question. Third question. Let's move on to fourth question. Fourth question is Jainism believed in. So friends, here we have been asked that Jainism believed in which of the following? A. Law of Karma. Second, Ahimsa. Third, Brahmacharya. So friends, let me tell you that you will be able to judge that Ahimsa was the main principle of Jain tradition. So yes, they believed in Ahimsa. So obviously the answer would be that in which second option would be there. So obviously A and B are directly eliminated. So the options left are C and D. So let me tell you, friends, they also believed in law of karma and also in the Brahmacharya. So they believed in Brahmacharya as well as law of karma. So they believed that that a person is in cycle of birth and rebirth due to the karma. If one wants salvation or liberation from this cycle, he has to reform his karmas, and this can be done by renunciation, by material renunciation and following observing celibacy, that is Brahmacharya. So the correct option is D, that is 1, 2, and 3. So all the statement, all of these were believed in by Jainism. So non-injury was there in a kind of it was the kind of keystone of Jain philosophy, and also the principle has left its kind of lasting impact on the Indian thinking as a whole. If you observe the thinking of Gandhiji and others also, main national leaders, so they emphasized on the principle of Ahimsa. So it was it is a kind of principle that is followed by the present Indians also. So here, according to Jaina's teachings, the cycle of birth and rebirth was basically due to karma. So one can one can liberate from this by reforming his karma, and this can be done by monastic existence, that is by renouncing everything, by observing celibacy. So this celibacy is the condition that is called brahmacharya. So the focus was also there on brahmacharya. So the correct answer is D, that is 1, 2, and 3. So this is all about your fourth question. Let's move on to your fifth question. The fifth question is, with reference to Sangam literature and Vedic texts, consider the following statements. So friends, we have to consider the statements regarding Sangam and Vedic texts. First, both Vedic and Sangam texts are religious in nature. Second, unlike Vedic texts, Sangam texts do not provide any information on the political and economic life of people. So we have to tell which of the following statements is correct. So let me tell you, friends, that the first statement is clearly wrong, because Vedic literature is religious in nature, but the Sangam literature is secular in nature. So it is not religious in nature. And regarding second option, friends, second option is also incorrect, because Sangam texts also provide important information on political and economic life of people as well as their social life. So they provide a kind of they provide a code of conduct that is to be observed by the king and by the social that is to be observed by the people. And also it mentions important cities like Madurai. So such type of cities, port cities are also mentioned. So trade with Greeks is also mentioned. Greco-Roman trade is also mentioned. So both the statements are incorrect. So the solution is D, that is neither 1 and 2, neither 1 nor 2. So this is about your fifth question. So here, Greco-Roman trade we come to know about through Sangam literature, that is that the South India was engaged in trade with the Greeks and Romans, and also they also provide the information on code of conduct for kings and his court for other social groups also. So let's move on to your sixth question. Sixth question is, Sukta mentioned in early Vedic literature is. So friends, you might have heard about this word Sukta. So we have to tell that in early Vedic literature, it is associated with A, hymns in praise of god and goddesses, B, performance of sacrifice, C, slaves who were recaptured in war, D, priests who performed various rituals. So let me tell you, friends, that the Sukta in the early Vedic literature means the hymns in praise of gods and goddesses. So the Vedic literature, it contains several hymns like Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sam Veda, Tharv Veda. So there are multiple hymns in these. So basically the hymns that were in praise of gods and goddesses were referred to as Suktas. So the solution is A. So the Rig Veda includes more than 1,000 hymns. There are 1028 hymns. So it literally means well said. So these hymns are in the praise of various gods and goddesses. And there were main three gods during the early Vedic age, that is Agni and Indra, the warrior god, and the Soma, special plant from which a special drink was prepared. So here is A is correct. So the people who composed the hymns described themselves as Aryas, and their opponents were described as Dasas and Dasyus by them. And later on, this term Dasas and Dasyus became prevalent in the sense of slave. So today we use this word, that is das, hum to aapke das hai ji. So that thing das, the das thing is slave. We can say slaves. So slaves were women and men basically who were captured during the war. So this is all about your sixth question. Let's move on to the seventh question. Seventh question is, which of the following major rock edict and pillar edict of Ashoka elaborates Dhamma policy? So friends, it is important. Please remember it. There are major main rock edicts and pillar edicts of Ashoka. You have to remember them, that the main those main pillars and rock edicts. So it is important for your prelims. So option is option is 11th and 6th, B is 10th and 11th, C 11 and 10th, D 3rd and 11th. So let me tell you, friends, that the Dhamma policy of Ashoka is elaborated in 11th and 6th this rock edict and pillar edicts. So the A option is correct option. So here is the description. So here in the description, I have included all of the rock edicts. Rock edict 1 prohibits animals slaughter and also bans festive gatherings and killings of animals. So only 2 peacocks and 1 deer were killed in Ashoka. Kokka's kitchen. He wished to discontinue this practice of killing two peacocks and one deer as well. So in Rock Addict 1, there is ban on animal slaughter. Please remember this. In Rock Addict 2, there was kind of a direction for providing for care for men and animals. That describes about Chola and Pandyas, Satapura, Keralaputra, kingdoms of South India. So it from Rock Addict 2, we come to know about the kingdoms that were southern to the political territory of King Ashoka. So regarding third, it was basically a kind of direction towards showing generosity to Brahmins, and also it was issued after 12 years of Ashoka's coronation. So when after 12 years of his coronation, so it says that the Yuktas and Pradeshikas along with Rajukas shall go to all areas of kingdom every 5 years and spread the Dhamma policy of Ashoka, and there is for Rock Addict 4 that is major Rock Addict 4 Dharma Gosha is ideal to the main count and not the Beri Gosha, impact of Dhamma on society. So it basically talks about that Dhamma is kind of a better ideal for mankind and not Beri Gosha, that is not that violence is not the solution for humankind. So it also tells about the impact of Dhamma on society. So there were major Rock Addicts, so you have to read about all about you have to read about them in detail. So this is about your major Rock Addicts. So they are quite large in numbers, so it is difficult to explain each and every one here. So please see in the PDF which I will provide to you. So friends, let me tell you that if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these MCQs, you can message us at this number. The number is given here, 8968426481. So friends, as we are putting in a lot of effort, so certainly there will be a certain cost after which you will be subscribed to these PDFs of daily MCQs. So in this way, you will be covering the most important questions of prelims 2019. So let's move on to your next question. The next question is about 8th question. Which of the following are the differences between Sultanate and Mughal styles of architecture? Friends, here also is a mistake. This is a question of medieval India. It has been included in ancient India. So please bear with us. So the first is Charbagh style. Second is Petra Dura ornamentation. Third is use of red sandstone. So we have to choose the correct option code given below. So let me tell you, friends, that Charbagh style and Petra Dura ornamentation was typical to Mughal architecture. It was not there in Sultanate. But let me tell you that sandstone was both used by the Sultanate as well as by the Mughal emperors. So the third is not the correct. But yes, one Charbagh style and Petra Dura ornamentation was typical to Mughal style of architecture. So the correct answer is D. So it has been included by mistake. So sorry for that. And both are characteristics of Mughal style of architecture. So basically, Charbagh style is shown here in the diagram. Here, there was a kind of a park that was on four sides. It was divided into four square. Patterns through which the lanes passed, and there were water channels that were passing through these parks. So the char parts of the park was divided through narrow water channels that were passing through them in kind of perpendicular format. So this Petra Dura is also intricate inlaid pictures from shaped colored stones. So you might have also seen about Petra Dura, but let me tell you that red sandstone was both used by Mughal architecture as well was used by both Mughals as well as by Delhi Sultans. So this is about your 8th question. Let's move on to the 9th question. The 9th question is, in the context of Bhakti tradition of South India, consider the following pairs. Friends, let me tell you that this is also a question of medieval India. So it is kind of I have made this PDF in a hurry, so that's why this confusion followed. But no issues. It is obviously a reading. It is not waste of time. So you can read. The first is Nalaira Divya Prabandham, a composition of Lingyats criticizing Veda. Second is Andal, a female devotee of Vishnu. Third is Tevaram, a composition of poems by saints. So we have to choose that which of the following is correctly matched. Let me tell you, friends, that Nalaira Divya Prabandham is incorrectly matched, because it is basically the composition of alvars, the various alvars that were the Vishnu bhakts in South India. So it is basically Nalaira Deva Prabandhan is a composition of alvars, and it is also sometimes referred to as Tamil Ved. So it has been emphasized that this is equal to the four Vedas of that are written in Sanskrit. So it is also referred to as Tamil Veda. So it is basically composition of alvar saints that were followers of Vishnu. And second statement is, yes friends, it is correct, because Andal was a devotee, female devotee of Vishnu, and she composed various poems in praise of Lord Vishnu, which were sung among the common people during that time. So second is also correct, and third is also correct, that Tevaram was basically a composition of poems by different saints. So second and third are correct, but the first is not correct, because it is the basically composition of Nalaira Deva Prabandhan is the composition of alvars. So the correct answer is here only second and three. So option correct is B. So 2 and 3 only. So the solution is here B. So it is basically Nalaira Deva Prabandhan, it was composition of alvar saints, and it is described as Tamil Veda, and Andal was a woman alvar, and she was devotee of Vishnu, and the poems of Apar, Sambandar and Sundarar from Tevaram form the Tevarar, a collection that was compiled and classified in the 10th century on the basis of music and the songs. So let's move on to your last question. So friends, last question is about about the posture that different postures that were in which Buddha was shown to be meditating. So there are different postures. So here we have been asked to identify which of the following is the posture. So it is during meditation we come to know about the story that the Buddha was subjected to many temptations. There was an evil called Mara who wanted to disturb the meditation of Lord Buddha, and he bombarded him with his demons and monsters and violent storms and his three seductive daughters. So he tried to kind of interfere in the meditation process of Lord Buddha. So but the Buddha remained continuously in meditation, and then he thought of kind of testifying to Mara his meritorious past, and he points to the earth with his hand and calls the earth goddess. So the above description best describes which of the following mudras of Gautam Buddha. So basically to testify the Mara, he calls the earth goddess by touching it. So we have been asked that which of the following is that mudra of Gautam Buddha. A, Abhaya mudra. B, Jan Mudra, C, Vitarka Mudra, D, Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. Let me tell you friends that this is D, that is Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. So the solution is D. So here are the different mudras that are shown. Here Bhumi Sparsha Mudra is shown, in which earth was touched, and earth was invoked as a kind of witness to the truth of his words, and there was a Varada Mudra, fulfillment of all wishes, the gesture of charity. So kind of in which Lord Buddha is shown like the hand. Let me tell you the way that when the Buddha points his hand in this way, then this is Varada Mudra. Then there is Dhyan Mudra, in which he sits his hands like this. So then there is also Akshaya Mudra. So I am totally becoming like Lord Buddha. So I am not trying to hurt any religious feelings. So don't, I am not even close to his feet, man. Don't get emotional if anybody is from Buddhism. I do respect your emotions. So there are different mudras. So you can see here. So you can check in the PDF that I will provide. So friends, this is all about today's lecture. If you liked it, please like it, share it with your friends. If you got benefit of it, and if you like the questions, then do tell me in the comment box, that questions are certainly of value. And I will, as the prelim comes near, I will try to increase the number of questions. Currently, we are covering 10 questions due to the limitation of time. So I will try to cover 20 questions in a day as the prelim approaches. So we will be obviously upgrading your preparation in a proper manner. In the month of May itself, I assure you that I will daily post 30 questions of each topic. So in the May month itself, I will try to cover your 900 to 1000 questions. So before that, I will try to increase the number of questions to 20 or 15. So this friends, if you want to subscribe to the PDFs of these videos, these video lectures, then you can WhatsApp us at this number, that is 8968426481. This is the this is our official number of our channel, and no other number is used to provide to you in PDFs. So if you want to subscribe to the PDFs, then you can do WhatsApp us. You can do WhatsApp to us at this number. So friends, obviously there are nominal charges that we will charge for you people for this purpose, because obviously we are putting in a lot of efforts. And if you want the explanation PDF, then you can do WhatsApp us. And why friends, it is important to subscribe to these, because at the end of the day you will not be able to see 30 to 40 minute long video, because at the end of the day you must have some kind of notes to revise quickly. So also at that time you will not be able to read NCERTs or for that matter standard books, because at that time there is a lot of pressure to complete the syllabus and to revise it multiple times. So the only effective way of revision is by doing MCQs and then following MCQ pattern, in which you see a question and then you go for its answer and then you go for its explanation. So in this way your revision takes place in a proper manner, and you cover all important aspects, because questions are framed in keeping in mind the pattern of UPSC. So in this way your revision takes place in an effective manner. So if you want to subscribe to the explanation PDFs, you can do WhatsApp us this number. So this is all about friends today's lecture. If you liked it, please like it, share it with your friends, and please subscribe to our channel if you like that video. And do not forget to press the bell icon, because then only you will get all the important notifications relating to UPSC CSE 2019 that we do on our YouTube channel. So thank you friends, thank you very much, have a nice day.